Good morning. Once again, warm welcome to everybody here in the Reinvention Laboratory. I'm Corinna Egra, and I have the great pleasure to be your host during this entire Reinvention Lab. This is already our fourth day of the laboratory, and we've had very interesting discussions so far, and interesting days together with you, all the participants here in the audience. And yes, I'm sure we have another very exciting day ahead of us. Welcome to the first session of this Thursday, Sustained Collaboration for Industry 4.0. That's the topic we're going to talk about today. And I have the pleasure to introduce to you now Alexander Bentkes. Alexander, welcome on stage.
Thank you.
Alexander, you work for a DKE German National Committee within Industry 4.0, and you coordinate a nationwide science project regarding reliable industrial radio communication systems for the Federal Ministry of Science and Education. Is that right?
Yes, exactly.
And you have the pleasure to now, well, pretty now soon, have to take over the session from me, to host the session. But before, we do have to explain an important feature of our general meeting app that you probably all have on your smartphones already, because you're going to do an app poll later.
Yes.
So when Alexander asks you to take out your smartphones later to do the poll, to take the poll, then you please, and I'm just going to tell you how that works now, please take out your smartphones then and go to the main menu, navigate to the Reinvention Laboratory agenda, and then select the session you're in now and move to the horizontal menu. And there you'll see a thing that's called poll, and then take the poll, and in the end, that's very important, please submit your response. Otherwise, we're not going to get your results. And, well, Alexander, now, have fun here on stage.
Yeah, thank you.
The floor is yours.
Yeah, good morning. Thanks for your interest in our session, Smart Manufacturing. Digitalization of our life isn't something new and changed already our behavior. Everybody of us has already a smartphone in the pocket, or somebody has two smartphones. So we are already well connected. We are exchanging via social network and social media in real time. And digitalization of the whole life cycle of products and even manufacturing plants are quite more complex and challenging, and not surprisingly, still in progress. The vision is to break the fixed installed series production, opens flexible, configured, and in advance, fully digital, simulated, and optimized production system and human machine collaboration. Therefore, we don't want to talk about today about what is smart manufacturing. No, we want to step into the next gear, and we want to talk about how to implement Industry 4.0. And we want to go through four key standardization organizations according to our general meeting slogan, connecting communities. I promise you very interesting keynotes from senior experts and executives, spotlighting various viewpoints regarding smart manufacturing in the future. We will start recently launched German initiative, the Standardization Council, Industry 4.0, where Reinhold Pichler will give us an overview. Yeah, Reinhold Pichler, please welcome to the stage. Reinhold Pichler is the Managing Director of the new founded Standardization Council, and he will give us an overview what's going on there. Please. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, also a very warm welcome from my side. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to present you the new founded Standardization Council, Industry 4.0, and want to explain a little bit what it is and especially what we are doing in that field. So the initiators of the Standardization Council were the associations here in Germany, like the Bitkom, which covers the IT sector, like the ZVEI, which covers the Elektrotechnik sector, VDMA, the machine building engineering, and of course the standardization organizations DKE and DIN. And also a major player in the Standardization Council is the platform industry 4.0. With the platform also we are working very close and very heavily to get up and to set up the strategies with regards to norms and standardizations. So exactly what is our strategic orientation? It says the Standardization Council has to coordinate standardization and regulation work in the field of industry 4.0 in Germany especially, and of course beyond our borders. It's not a German issue, it's a worldwide issue, and we have to connect and we have to talk with other countries to harmonize processes regarding norms and standardization. We have to talk with them, and we have a lot of initiatives with that, and we are working also here very close with the Ministry of Economy in Germany, where we coordinate a little bit our bilateral agreements with the countries. And we also represent the interests of Industry 4.0 in the field of national, European and international standardization. If you see this picture, this is a small triangle where it says the circles. There is one, the Standardization Council. That means we are initiating cross-sectoral standards. This is one of our major tasks. That means if a new standard has come up to the way, we decide in what kind of organization or where we put this from German side into IEEE, IEC, whatsoever. Yeah. Then we coordinate national, international standards, and we strengthen also what I just said before, the international cooperation. Then we work hand in hand with the industry, with the platform Industry 4.0. There is one sub working group, which is called the Reference Architecture and Standardization. So here, let's say the strategic direction of major topics are given, like reference architecture model, like the Industry 4.0 component, or the administration shell. These are the topics we're working on. And the other one here, what we see is the Labs Networks Industry. It's a new founded association which covers the test field application in Germany. In Germany, we have about 34 test fields, test application centers, where you can go there and test your test your whatsoever, your standard, your protocol, and so on and so on. And out of this test, the lab network inventory, we are there also, and we see, are there any points which we have to put into a standard, or then in the next stage into a norm. So you see, we are close to strategic level, up to the real work, what we have to do with standardization, and then also you can test it, and this also is coordinated via the Standardization Council 4.0. If you go a little bit more in detail, this is just, you see, the strategic work with the platform Industry 4.0, strategic direction. Then we have a small, let's say, organization like the expert panel. The expert panel, there are 30, 40 people from industry, from economy, from universities is taking up these strategic directions, and we decide what kind of organization we have. We have two different kinds of standardization. The first one is, let's say, the consensus-based standardization, which is very important. Or say, okay, in the national level, it's the DKE and the DIN. On the European level, it's IEC, CENELEC, or CENELEC. And on the international level, of course, IEC, ISO. On that way, that means here we have consensus-based standardization, here we have a clear process. But very important is the left side, what you see there, this consortiums. Yeah? And it's very important now to focus also on these consortiums, because they are also working on Industry 4.0, but they have different processes regarding how a standard, let's call it like this, or a paper is coming up. So it will end in a de facto standard or an open source, or and they have consortia consensus. So here we have to take care, and also here we are investigating Industry 4.0 relevant consortiums and try to evaluate what exactly do we also need from them regarding Industry 4.0. We talk with them. We also bring people into that consortiums to get, if possible, also an international standard via IEC. Could be also one of the possibilities. So we are evaluating consortiums, and we put it also, and we try to bring it also within the IEC or the ISO, wherever it is necessary. Or we just participate and see, okay, we have to follow that way, but we are doing this work. So the requirements for successful Industry 4.0 standardization bring here 5 points. what I just said, work with international forums, consortia needs to be intensified. This is one of the major tasks of the Standardization Council. We have to ensure interoperability without within 4.0, and this is one of the points we have to take care. Efficient collaboration between international standard organizations, of course, this is what we're doing heavily with IEC, of course, with ISO and other organizations. Worldwide accepted reference model. This is also one thing where we're working on right now. So the reference architecture model proposed from Germany, we bring it now into, we brought it in the IEC, and we are doing now a public available specification out of this. I saw it just today, it's for free for commenting. And also this one is public available then, and then we have to decide with other countries or for bilateral negotiations, how to harmonize this architecture model within other different states like Japan, like China, whatsoever. And very important also the network test centers, what I just mentioned, these are we're doing via the laboratory network. So, and the output of this, we bring it back and validate it for standardization. Also the test application, and this also is a very good step for small and medium enterprises because they can join and they can test the application. And also the last point what I have here is the aspects of standardization integrated into national and international research projects. This means from the beginning we are going with them, and then after, if it is developed, we also see is there a standardization required or not. So it's pre-work, and if this project comes out of research and development and maybe it goes to production, then we see, we fill the gaps where we have to work and where we have to put it on. So these are the 5 points. I have still three seconds. Thank you very much. We can discuss these issues. And by the way, also the Standardization Council has a booth outside. So if you come anytime, please, then we can go a little bit more detail into that topic. Then that's it for the first time. Thank you very much. And yeah.
Yeah, thanks, Reinhold. Yeah, next speaker is Dr. Schlesinger from TÜV Süd. TÜV is well known as the organization for technical safety. Was it in the past more hardware related, becomes now the digital security. And Dr. Schlesinger will open a critical view which directly influences the digitalization of plants and infrastructure. Yeah, Mr. Schlesinger, please.
Thank you.
Dr. Schlesinger is the Chief Digital Officer of the TÜV Süd Group.
Welcome and good morning. I'd like to present you the results of a little experiment we have been doing a while ago, which was called a honey net. And the takeaways I'd like you to take with you is, as soon as you are on the internet, as soon as you're in the network, you will be discovered and likely attacked. The second thing is, independent of the size of your organization, the attacks will be very professional. So it's not just a normal office IT. There will be other protocols which also go into the industrial space. The third point, you need to strive for security by design. So it's not just a little bit of a firewall here, an antivirus there. It is central logging, central analysis. You might want to think about a security strategy and about the whole thing, the holistic approach covering the technology, the process, but also the people. So this is somebody, I think everybody knows that. Viruses, worms, spyware, rootkits have been going up wildly, almost exponentially, the last few years. And since 2014, with Stuxnet as being the first, let's say, cyber weapon of mass destruction, you remember the incident in Iran, we have advanced threats out there, which are now, you know, purported to endanger all of us. 10,000 of new malware samples per hour. One could make the claim that 100% of all large organizations have had traffic on malicious websites. But what we were not quite sure about is how much happens in the industrial space. So what we did is we set up an experiment to find out how that works. So basically, the idea was to build a simulation of a public waterworks, Wasserwerk. Not the real waterworks with all the tanks and pumps, but an approximation of how that could look like into internet. So what we did this mock-up, not just on a software basis, but also on a hardware basis. So we did purchase the industrial controls, which in a real waterwork do drive the pumps and the valves and all that stuff. and build a what we have called a high interaction honeynet, because it was hardware and software. The second thing is, of course, it had to be manageable not just from a cost perspective, but also from an IT perspective. So we had to partition the infrastructure, not work with the regular IT organization, because they will kill you if you invite attacks. So we set aside a different physical network to make that happen and ran it for 8 months. And then last but not least, of course, we could have counterattacked. You should not do something illegal. How did it look like in the end? Like this. So it's not something fancy. It's basically a refrigerator-based sized box with a few Siemens PCS7s on top, a laptop, a PC, and a honey box, which is basically a device which can simulate a lot of logical devices in a network. So just in terms of like what was the result of the whole exercise, some numbers, I'm not going to go into the architecture, but you could see that there was a good mix of, let's say, real and not so real things. After 8 months, we analyzed, we logged the whole traffic for that time, and in the first first glance, looked at where do the attempts to attack or the attempts to, you know, basically get connection to a port or get into the whole contraption here, where do they come from? Most of them come from China and the United States, and then you have a motley crew, a good mix of other countries, from South Korea to India to Germany to basically all of these spaces. I'll get into that, you know, but it would be a wrong conclusion to say that all the Chinese and the US are there, are the places where the attacks do come from. Actually, it's not the case, because you can fake IP addresses and pretend that you're living somewhere where you're not physically living. The second thing is we looked at is, are these the, you know, well-known internet protocols, SNMP, for instance, or VNC, when you have a remote management software like, you know, TeamViewer or Timbuktu Remote, if you're an Apple person, VNC is what you use. So indeed, the majority of the attacks came through the normal internet protocols, but there have been quite a few, actually, which have given us the indication that these people do know what they're doing. They have been using industry protocols, Modbus or the Siemens protocol S7 Common, S7 Com Plus. And again, you see United States and China being up there, but you know, if you go for the industrial controls, you have Ukraine out there and Germany out there. So not necessarily is everything coming from the same place. Briefly, the observations. After looking through this wealth of 8 months of attack data, what we came up with that the access attempts are global in nature. They come from everywhere, as you have seen. Very often, and you see that in this blue table here, you cannot trust the IP addresses. What you see here is IP addresses 61234.24. You will not find anywhere on the internet. It's certainly an address somebody made up. It does not exist, right? The second thing is 8844 is actually a DNS resolution service which Google offers as a service. Certainly Google did not attack our waterworks. And then you go the SANS Internet Storm Center, which is even more misleading, because it's an organization which does track internet attacks and attempt DNS attempts. Then last but not least, we had the Polish parliament attacking our waterworks. Not very likely. So you see, do not trust the address where the attack is seemingly coming from. And as you can see, then if you go down there, a few of them have been actually quite advanced. So an SNMP, which is standard internet protocol, we did have denial of service attacks, but also denial of service attacks via botnets. So not just one computer trying to get into the whole thing, but a whole network of computers that work together to stage an attack. On the S7 protocol, we did have a few unauthorized reads of the control program. So somebody got as far in as to be able to read memory. And some of the attackers actually even succeeded in manipulate memory. Now, they manipulated something. They didn't know what they're manipulating. So they had no clue of like the whole control logic works. So first you have to understand the program, and then you can attack purposefully. They had changed something. But you know, it could be the case that it would have been something which opens a valve and the water tank of a city or of a village is basically emptied by opening this valve. Again, what I said in the beginning, it's global attacks. They're quite professional. They're not limited to a large, important company. Basically, as soon as you have an IP address out there, you will be attacked. And it's not just the standard internet stuff, it's also now industrial protocols. So what you need to do is to think about how you can counter this. One thing is, and I briefly mentioned it, you have to log these events, because if you log them, you can analyze them. The second thing is, you might want to think about a centralized analysis, wouldn't say department, but some instance which can analyze the traffic, what's going on in your network, what's going on with your devices. And last but not least, you have to think about a holistic approach. What we see here is a quite recent study where the reason for network outages, I mean, something you could do with the kind of attack we've just been seeing, you could make happen. And it came out that only 7% have been security breaches in the sense there was a deliberate attack. Other stuff was software or hardware glitches. I mean, things just didn't work the way they're supposed to. There were power outages, still be a main reason for network outages. The telecom service provider was not always a party you wanted to work with. But the biggest factor in outages was actually the human error. So what you really want to think about if you think Industry 4.0, if you think, can I make my network, my automation safe from, or at least, you know, try to make it safe from cyber attacks, as we have seen, you have to think about the human factor. So you have to think about the things, the network, of course, the processes, I mean, the security process, how you manage your data storage, how you manage your security processes, how you make sure that the people, only those have access to the right domains which are supposed to have access, how you have how you make sure that rights and keys are administered properly. Only then I think you have a chance to fight off what we have seen is out there, global attacks, quite professional on your internet, but also in physical networks. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Schlesinger. And I want to start now with the first poll. We have two polls in our session, and I hope you have already installed our general meeting app, and we have there prepared two polls. And the first poll is regarding security, and Dr. Schlesinger worked out in his keynote the real threat of cyber attacks. So, is smart manufacturing Industry 4.0 by full connectivity and digitalization in reality an easy victim of the tablet of cyber attacks? Now it's your turn. So, the question is, will we be able to secure the digital manufacturing infrastructure through standardization despite massive growing cyber attacks? Our standards will be able to cover all threats, that would be option one. Or standards will cover all aspects, but new threats must be handled individually. And the third answer would be, no, threats come more complex and can't be covered by standards. So please vote, and in the discussion later on, we will then pick up the vote and discuss with that with Dr. Schlesinger. We are now taking a deeper view on the main standard organization beside IEC. And we start with ISO, where Alexander McNeil will give us an overview. He's the principal advisor for global product standards and regulations at Rockwell Automation. And he's the convener of the IEC SGH Group Industry 4.0 and SMB member for the United States. Yeah, please welcome Alexander McNeil. And
thank you.
Yeah. As you see, the animation is slower than you, so we have to
slow down.
Slow down, yes.
Okay.
I hope we have picked up the main important items, but yes. Later on we see it. So, thank
okay.
you.
Thank you. I was invited to come and address this morning about, and I thought it was going to be just about smart manufacturing and Industry 4.0, and I got here and they said, no, we really want to focus on collaboration between ISO, IEC, ITU, JTC1, consortia, and how do we attack the massive monster? So I'm going to do my best to do what I've been asked to do, and we'll give you some very good new information because SEG7 only just met yesterday for its first meeting, and we have already made some progress. So I just want to start off with a smart grid look, and the way that the industrial automation and the factory people addressed the smart grid was to say, look, we're going to treat factories and manufacturing enterprises as smart nodes on smart grids. We are going to have an industry grid interface, and we will manage the distribution of electricity within our own four walls. We'll convert the electricity into air or gas or steam, and we'll just have our own, if you like, smart industrial grid within the four walls of the manufacturing enterprise. And for the smart grid purposes, we'll have a very intelligent interface to the substation or the where we derive the power from the grid. And that was fine. That made life a little bit easier because we were still in control of our own destiny inside the four walls of the factory. What it did do was we were beginning to then start to transform the factories from sort of passive to active energy management, rather than just being net consumers of energy and in some cases returning energy back to the grid. We now became more of an active role within the customer's base. If you think about smart manufacturing industry 4.0, one way that we look at it is through manufacturing chains. We need to really trace material from wherever that material source is in whatever enterprise. How does it travel down through the different factories, through the different places, so that when that material ends up as inside a product in a customer's hands, we can actually give some faith and some credibility that it doesn't have toxic chemicals in it. It is safe and it is environmentally acceptable. We also nowadays have to think about energy. I just talked about that. We have to track energy. We can track energy. We can decide how much energy we want to use. If we turn the energy down, the processes will go slower. The productivity will go down. But that may be something that the management of the business want to do to compensate for other areas of the factory. Obviously, product life cycle from design idea through assembly, test, delivery, application, use and service is a life cycle through the whole enterprise that people well know and talk about. A little less talked about, but is exactly the same, the factory life cycle. Factories don't just appear. There have to be investments made. There has to be business justifications. You have to decide what process and automation you're going to put in there and plan. There's a lot of modeling and simulation of that design plant before you start to make the expenditure to acquire the resources, build and commission the plant, and get it up into production operations. So that is another life cycle model that is pervading through the enterprise. Supply chain is a very well known. People talk about the supply chain, how you buy products that are integrated into your own products. How do you make sure that those products are quality, those products are up to the specifications that you require? One of the interesting things about supply chains is with the amount of data now that's available and the intelligence in the supply chain, you would think it would be easier to control the supply chain. Unfortunately, and I'll talk about this again later, is what the digitalization is doing is making data available. But the question you have to ask is, available to who? And available in what context? The mere fact that a supplier who's four or five stages down upstream from you is providing something that eventually reaches you, there may be an attribute, a product aspect, or an attribute of that device that you end up with that you would really like to know what the real instance is. You know what the specification is maybe, but you don't know what the actual value is for that, the instance that arrived at your plant. It would be nice to think that, oh, I want it, I can just go out on the net, I can find it. But you might, if you want it in a real-time control situation, you can't afford to wait for the time delays of the net, assuming that it was already public information. Sometimes that information is not available publicly because that company believes it's part of their intellectual property or it's part of their own trade secret, So if you really want to use that attribute and improve your process for whatever reason, you're probably going to have to go, first of all, you have to find the owner of it, then you have to go and negotiate whether they will do a license agreement or something to give you access to that data. Then you have to make sure you can get the access on a timely basis and get good quality data. Order to entry, from the day the customer places the order to delivery is another chain that goes through with a lot of data that relies or could be improved with access to data from the shop floor, and the shop floor process could be improved with access to data from those supply chains. We all talk about asset management and machine asset management. We need to remember human resources, people, are all part of the HR management system. And that usually is viewed as just an IT system. And it's got separate data entry points on computers for timesheets and attendance and everything else. But if you think about it as a resource, and you think about the way that we describe machines, and we say we've got specifications for machines, electrical, mechanical, we've got performance parameters, we've got capabilities for machines, we can do a similar digital profile for a human resource. Every human resource has got different skill levels, different certifications or accreditations, different levels of experience. So you need to digitally model the human aspect as well. And that is equivalent to modeling the physical assets. And finally, everybody wants to know why we do this, and we do it for money. No question, we do it for profitability. And we need to track those costs and which parts of the organization are net drains on the euro and which ones are actually producing the euro, and make sure that overall we get what we want at the end of the day. So standards, as I say, are everywhere. Here is a picture of the supply chain of an enterprise. And then I can go through here and say, oh, Ross. Conflict minerals, green, worker certifications. Then we've got social accountability. And I'm putting on here a lot of ISO standards to remind you that we have to interface from an electromechanical control aspect into these other environments where these standards are written by other people, or traditionally have been written by other people. We have the ISO series 9000, 14000, 5001, energy efficiency standards, product standards, and what ISO is working on currently are standards around key performance indicators, trying to find a standardize a way that you can actually identify what is the key performance or process indicator and then manage and use it. Oops. Environmental safety, electromagnetic capability, very important as we move more and more into wireless and radio spectrum. In fact, the industry, SG8, Strategic Group 8, made a move to talk and collaborate with ITU, and we are actively involved in the next round of discussion on spectrum allocation. And what we're asking for is, can we have a reserve spectrum for critical infrastructure to be reserved for those plants or those railway transportation centres or hospitals that are really, really critical and need to be protected? Product cataloging, supply chain integration. One of my biggest nightmares for the last 3 or 4 years of my working career was import-export logistics. Since the way that companies have grown up, the IT systems that provide the labels that go on the product, the labels that go on the shipping carton, the invoices that are produced, and the bills of lading that go with the equipment come from different IT systems, and they all come on from data that was put in independently and separately. So if you get to the situation that the label in the box says PLC Series 1, the carton just says PLC, the actual bill of freight material says automation equipment, your invoice says PLC Series 1, Volume 2, da da da. When it gets to customs, and especially in a country like China where the English is not the natural language, and they happen to just do a spot check and open the box, or even just compare the label with the paperwork, everything stops. Because in a pattern recognition, this is 10 alphanumeric characters different to the one I'm looking at. Stops. You don't necessarily get called. you and suddenly find that you're missing a shipment, you make the call, and you get 2 or 3 weeks inbuilt delay just because of the incompatibility of the statements of the data. Smart manufacturing is only going to be work when we get ourselves consistent and repeatable in the way we treat data. The digital world is a black and white world. The human world is gray. We use our brains to take a sense of a sentence, and even if it's not complete, we interpret it to make it complete and do the synonymous. Computers at this point in time are not going to be able to do that until we build up a wealth of history, and then it might be able to make those educated guesses. But initially, it's either the same or it's different. Just a warning. So, I just talked about assets. Physical assets can be described by a digital list of properties, mechanical, electro, etc. I just remind you, human assets can be described the same way. So as those assets are used and as they depreciate with time or get the performance degrades with time, those profiles are updated and you can compensate for that degradation in your planning and scheduling, know when to do your maintenance cycles and everything else. Today, IEC and ISO are working together to enhance the common data dictionary to support the list of properties for mechanical and electrical products. And we're out, literally going out to encourage the product TCs in both ISO and IEC to start to put data into that common data dictionary so we can start to standardize some of the data and the attributes of products and systems so that they're available for use in the digital world. Today, ISO had a committee, that strategic group, that was looking at Smart Manufacturing Industry 4.0. They made a report to the TMV. The TMV made a recommendation to the IEC that we should collaborate in architecture standardization. And yesterday, SEG7, as was delegated by the SMV, made the decision and passed that task. We agreed, IEC TC 65 accepted the fact that they will willingly work with TC 184 SC5 and the architecture, and to look at architectures. They talked about the architecture model of industry and Industry 4.0 and NIST, and the group said we're going to include other architectures, and JTC 1 Working Group 10, the IoT people, I'm sure are going to participate in that discussion. So now we're starting to get joint working groups and things working in the space of architecture. We're not having separate silos of architecture. IEC and ISO are collaborating in the development of a common definition for smart manufacturing. And again, ISO TMV said the SAG report, they liked the report. It had a definition of smart manufacturing, but they would rather see, they wanted to see a smart manufacturing definition consistent with IEC. So as part of our work now, we're going to work with the ISO folk to come up with a standard for a definition for standards purposing of what smart manufacturing means. ISO TMV, as I said, have formed their coordinating committee. They've opened the door for IEC participation. We are working on what the IEC response is going to be, how we're going to collaborate and coordinate all the work both within the IEC TCs, and however that structure is recommended. The likelihood is that the leader of that group will then will sit on, there'll be an exchange of seats and liaison at that level. IEC and ISO are collaborating in the establishment. One of the things the ISO SAG asked for was a smart grid. Remember the smart grid when it first came out and it had a roadmap and it had the standards in the portfolio. They wanted to see a similar thing for smart manufacturing, but they wanted to see, they asked for that it be considered to be put on the IEC IT platform in collaboration with the IEC. We have already started to work on that. There are already existing standards analyses from the ISO SAG work, from a NIST study on smart manufacturing, version 1 came out about 18 months ago, and from work we did in SG8. So we've got the beginnings of the standards portfolio, and we've already started to talk to the systems resource group in the IEC about the tool that will actually be used to navigate, to take that portfolio of standards, put it out in a physical representation form that's easy to navigate for the end user, the OEM, not for the standards geeks. This, we've got to get to the customer. One of the feedbacks I had in the US on the Industry 4.0 model with end user industries was, what's this? Because it's a multi-dimensional layer model, and they couldn't relate that to, well, I'm a quality engineer, or I am a machine operator, or I just run a factory. What does this mean? And so one of the things I'm learning very quick is we have to get out of the technical and then think about the standards and the standards language, and then we have to take both the technology and the standards language and convert it into something that the user can understand. And we're talking about a big domain, smart manufacturing, but most users don't exist in the big. That's just a CEO somewhere and a board of directors. Most users who are going to make a difference have a small piece of this pie. And they want to get to the piece that affects them and find the standards and the work groups that's going to affect them in the whole. And that's okay. So lastly, smart manufacturing is a result of decisions that create actions. And those decisions, is if they're based on quality data, for the key criteria for the decision, it will be the best decision you can make. So the question about how does manufacturing become smart, you have to make sure that whenever a machine or a person is making a decision, they have quality data. If there's a missing data piece, that decision is subject to question and maybe an approximation as opposed to a factual piece of information. Remember that the manufacturers themselves are trying to optimize mitigating risk for safety and security, optimizing energy and environment, and minimizing environmental impacts, reducing costs, improving performance. If you try and say, I want to do all of these, that's impossible. It's a balance. You can't reduce cost and increase productivity very easily unless you make a capital investment in some capital. But you can't maximize all of those. You've got to compromise somewhere. And it will be different for different manufacturers, and that becomes a real problem because you can't standardize it to a point that every manufacturer of a car is going to use the same systems and the same process, because the competitive edge is going to be difficult. I'll leave it there. The last thing is on collaboration. And we do need, in the standards world, better IT tools. We are here talking about using digital to make smart manufacturing, smart energy, smart this, smart that. We've got Facebook, we've got Twitter. And we are using archaic tools in the standards world. Every SDO is behind the times. Even the IEC, ISO, we are making some efforts, but we've got to bring the standards world into the modern world. Sorry, I exceeded my time.
Thank you, Alexander McNellan. So, I learned that joint tools between IEC and ISO are necessary next steps. Okay, we are now having IT on the radar screen, and I want to introduce Heimo Hule. He's the head of technical legislation at the ZWEI, the German Electrical and Electronic Manufacturers Association. Heimo Hule's department deals with all aspects of standards and legal requirements. Yeah, please welcome Heimo Hule.
Yeah, thank you very much, Alexander. Good morning, everybody. I want to talk about interconnection, which is one of the cores of Industry 4.0, of course, because we need to interconnect the machines to each other to have the communication between all these. And the first idea would be to have wired connections, of course, that's quite clear. But there's a second one, and that's the wireless connection via radio functions. And in comparison with the wired connections, it offers a lot of advantages, you can imagine. It has a high flexibility, you can have it install it almost everywhere, and you can easily reconfigure it. Sorry, some words are a little bit difficult. And of course, it's less cost. There are estimations that it's half up to a third of the cost of wired interconnection. But what is very important for this? It needs to be available worldwide. Imagine that a machine manufacturer from country A buys radio modules in country B and delivers the complete machine in country C. Then you have to have a frequency band which works all over the world. A worldwide spectrum frequency band is needed. So, and we have one already. This is the ISM band for industrial, scientific, and medical purposes, in fact, but it's used for radio communication worldwide. And the 2.4 gigahertz band is worldwide used, but unfortunately, in Europe, we have big restrictions now to apply it, because we have a standard which has to be applied, mandatory, in fact, mandatory. And this standard says this is a worldwide used band and it's occupied by many, many people who do radio communication. So we have to introduce a mechanism called listen before talk. This means if a machine sends out a signal to do something, then this signal has to check whether the band is free or occupied. So, and this takes time. And you can imagine if you have to react very quickly between two machines within milliseconds, it's not achievable with listen before talk. And the situation, so this means we do not have deterministic applications, and this is what we need. And the situation in the 5.8 gigahertz band is even not better. We have other restrictions which don't help us. So the only solution, no, we may have another solution, the upcoming 5G mobile communication, which promises all these things that we require for our interconnection of machines. But without elaborating on the details, it may offer solutions, but for sure it's not the and not the only solutions. In the hands of the mobile networks operators, the question is whether the manufacturer in his factory wants to put his things in the hand of these operators. He will have to do on some way, but we have to see. And then the next question is, if you look at the current mobile communication bands, are they as stable as they are required for industrial applications? We cannot be sure that will be achieved with the 5G in time. So the only conclusion is that we need an own frequency band for wireless industrial applications. And we have two standards which describe the demands. First of all, it should be specific for these industrial applications and also technology neutral. It should, of course, that is the main goal, globally available and not overlapping with existing license exempt bands. According to the frequency, we have to be above 1.4 gigahertz, because below are the disturbances and emissions of welding machines and other machines, which cause interferences and make communication more difficult. And above 6 gigahertz is not feasible neither, because then we get quasi-optical propagation of the waves. We need a site, and we want to radio around the corner, let's say. So this is the requirement we have. A bandwidth of 80 megahertz is needed due to the data rate and all the restrictions we have. Yeah, and of course, it needs to guarantee the intended operation by an appropriate status and conditions. And this is where now regulation comes into the game, because the frequency bands are regulated in ITU, the International Telecommunications Union, and the WRC, the World Radio Conference. The ITU is an organization of the United Nations and is responsible for many things in telecommunications and as well as for the allocation of frequency bands. And the ITUR, the subcommittee on regulation, hosts the World Radio Conference, which has its global meetings every 3 to 4 years. The last was last year, 2015, so the next one will be in 2019. And as you can imagine, the whole world is sitting together for several weeks in Geneva and discuss about frequency bands and allocation and things. This requires some pre-work to be done to come into this World Radio Conference with a proposal. The ways to get there is either via national radio regulatory authorities or via the regional authorities or organizations like ACEPT in Europe, or we have, fortunately, between ISO, IEC and ITU, a cooperation agreement for many, many years now. And this is the way how to show now how to get the international standardization organizations into this game. It's a long way, I said it. The request for wireless industrial applications frequency band, first we launched via the relevant German ministry, and they supported and assisted us very good. We have to appreciate this very much, that the German ministry supported us in this approach and put the proposal to the WRC 15, the last year's World Radio Conference. But of course, it was too late. It could not be accepted as an agenda item. And furthermore, the wireless industrial applications are not an original radio service. They are an application under another radio service. This is another restriction. We were made aware. We were not really familiar with all these things. We had to study them and learn about. And so we received the advice from our authorities that we should launch a study item within ITUR on the needs, benefits, and requirements of the wireless industrial applications, with the aim to get it in the next World Radio Conference 2019. So now IEC comes into the game. It's a sector member of ITUR, and they made a proposal in November 2015 to ITUR to put this request on the WRC 19 agenda. And the successful result, after having finished the World Radio Conference last year, was the so-called Resolution 958, which in few words says that the World Radio Communication Conference resolves to complete studies on the topics identified in the annex, and you can read in the annex, studies have to be carried out on the technical and operational aspects of radio networks and systems, as well as spectrum needed, including possible harmonized use of spectrum to support the implementation of narrowband and broadband, and now we have it, machine-type communication infrastructures, in order to develop recommendations and things like that, that we can go on at least, yeah, that we can go on at least from 2019 on. So how are these study items produced now? The study item was allocated to the so-called Working Party 5D, which deals with international mobile telecommunication systems. But according to the ITU and the WRC, it seemed to be the right committee to deal with this. And so we have to go there, and we have to seek the cooperation, of course, now with the mobile network operators who are already committed to the Working Party 5D for many years. So this is another aspect. So we do not only have to cooperate with them about the wireless industrial applications with their own frequency band, but also, if possible, 5G applications could be applied as well. We have to look what is the best for each case of application. Yeah, and now, I'm rather quick. I come nearly to the end. Every group in this game plays a role. The industries have to send experts to the Working Party 5D, and this is really a hell of a job because they have very often meetings and have to discuss in detail things. Though this is a full-time job for several experts to be there, and this is task of industry, quite clear, to send these experts to go there. Then we have the kind support, the very good support of DKI, which hosts a research program with universities for reliable industrial communications, wireless communications, important wireless communications. They support us in doing this study program together with ITU and the Working Party. Then, of course, as Reinhold already introduced to you, the Standardization Council Industry 4.0 may assist us as well in bringing in specific aspects of smart manufacturing for these applications. And furthermore, IEC seeks the cooperation with 3GPP for standardization issues. 3GPP is a consortium located within ETSI, but it's a public-private partnership between industry and other stakeholders. They do all the mobile telecommunication standardization. For example, the GSM standard was elaborated by 3GPP, and they are active in this respect. So it's a good approach of IEC, as we heard from Alec in the previous presentation as well. We have to have an outreach to others. and 3 GPP is one example. We will have more, but this is one example, for example. And then, of course, the industry associations, and this is, again, a task for the industry and the associations. We have to seek the cooperation with the 5G community in politics, administration, and mobile network providers in order to get them accustomed, at least, and then please, hopefully, assist and support us in bringing through our needs as well in their domain. So that we have the complete spectrum now with an own frequency band and the collaboration with 5G for possible other solutions. And you see, it's a long-term activity which requires continuous commitment of all. So, and I think this was already... Seems so.
Yeah.
So, I finished. Thank you.
Thanks, Heimo. Yeah, Heimo, it sounds like a lot of work which is to be done for the ITUR initiative which is now in place. Yeah, Heimo asked about is 5G solution, and we are now taking a deeper look on 3GPP, and Gilles Tonnet will tell us more on 5G and the collaboration potential. He's the head of ICT standard coordination within the IEC central office, and the secretary of the SMB SG9 group. Yeah, please come on the stage and welcome Mr. Gilles Tonnet.
Thank you. So it looks like the previous speaker already introduced the topic, you know, very handsomely. And I'm going to have like 4 or 5 more minutes since he was also very fast. So don't worry. So I've been asked in this presentation to talk or to take a deeper look at 5G and potential collaboration with 3GPP, which was already introduced by the previous speaker. And I'm going to report on some work and findings done by SG9, which is a strategic group of the IEC SMB on communication technologies. This question about 3GPP actually came from another question asked by an SMB member, whether we should seek a deeper engagement with 5G standard setting organization and 3GPP more specifically. We have been through a lot of discussion in our last meeting, and I'm going to present you some already draft recommendations we have come through. Those haven't been submitted to the SMB yet. They're open for discussion, and we'll be very pleased to get your inputs as well. I just noticed on those slides that I put IEC GM 2017, which actually probably shows the forward-looking nature of SG9. So we're still in 2016, of course. So. In this presentation, I'm going to give you a very brief overview of what SG9 has been looking at, why 5G we believe is important for the IEC globally, and talking more about 3GPP, how or what could be the engagement models or engagement scenarios between the IEC and 3GPP. I will then finish with some recommendations we have come through as a group, which will be, of course, open for discussion. So, a few words about SG9. A strategic group within the, well, SMB, actually, are supposed to look at, let's say, forward-looking topics and give some recommendations back to the SMB on specific technologies or specific areas, whether the SMB should consider creating new group, creating new functions, or assigning new work items to existing technical committees. SG9 has been looking at communication technologies from a different perspective. So basically, technologies which are not really addressed or standardized within the IEC, but which might have an impact on what the IEC is doing. Examples may include 5G, for instance, or you can take other, let's say, fuzzy or nice trends like fog computing, like as well very low power what we called LRW PAN networks, very low power IoT networks. We look at the future of data centers as well. So a very broad range of technologies and trends which are not really at the core of the IEC, but we believe might have an impact in the future, and at least our technical committees should be aware of those trends and should be aware also of the organizations around us which are working on standardizing those technologies. SG9 will complete its work at the end of this year. There will be three main deliverables. First one, a number of use cases coming from the IEC community, which try to cluster the communication requirements and map those requirements to those emerging trends and technologies which are forming the second deliverable. And the third deliverable is a kind of survey of the external landscape. Who is doing what? So where you will find in that deliverable other organizations like 3GPP, ITU, IEEE, consortia, which perhaps the IEC should take a deeper look at. I have to say as well that as part of the work of SG9, we will produce a number of technical recommendations, but we also want to put a more strategic recommendation to the SMB. And this recommendation will be a way to continue this work within the IEC. One of the main findings the SG9 group actually reached consensus on was that this technology watch function should continue in one way or another within the IEC. It's not really done elsewhere, and the recommendation we will put might be a new group, perhaps an advisory committee, perhaps continuing this work under the SG9 banner, but we believe it's really important to keep this monitoring function. So now, let me jump into, the topic of today, 5G. We have had a lot of discussion. Why is 5G important to the IEC? There are a couple of different answers. We got already some of them in the previous presentations. There's a sense that 5G could really address multiple applications with one common technology. As you know, the IEC covers a broad range of applications. Take them, smart manufacturing, what we're talking about today, smart cities, smart homes, smart buildings, energy networks, of course. So 5G could kind of tackle all those applications with one common base technology. There are, of course, some new applications which are enabled or improved by 5G. I have listed in those slides a few of them, trying to relate them to some of the current technical activities we have in the IEC, whether we're talking about real-time industrial automation and robotics, or what we call sometimes tactile internet, augmented or virtual reality, ubiquitous cloud computing, well, you name them. But there are also other opportunities for the IEC in terms of, for instance, conformity assessment, which is the second big pillar of the IEC. EMC issues. As you know, we have a really big committee called CISPR looking at electromagnetic interference. We believe there are also great opportunities there for the IEC to be very much involved in this field. Although the IEC doesn't work directly on cellular technologies, but around 5G, there are many opportunities for IEC committees to get involved. Now, we look at the technology itself, 5G, what does it mean? And we have a really interesting debate in our last meeting, actually last month in Korea. There was some kind of a consensus among the group that 5G may mean a lot of things. There's no real common definition. Some people will approach 5G by listing a number of future applications which might be enabled by 5G. Others will look at some specific communication requirements. You will see below a number of requirements brought by the ITU. Looks a little bit like a wish list, right? So we don't really know whether those will be a reality soon or not. Some other people may look at 5G in terms of specific technologies or architectures, Well, it's a cellular plus probably wireless LAN plus probably wireless PAN, so the network you have around you, because we believe wearables will probably be part of, let's say, the global 5G pictures as well. So there are several ways of defining 5G, probably no real consensus on them. But if you look at this, sentence from Ericsson, unlimited access to data anywhere, anytime, for anyone and anything, sounds a little bit like a hype, a buzzword, but it probably encapsulates quite well what people have in mind when talking about 5G. The target is probably around 2020 for this technology to come to maturity. Interestingly, when I was in Korea last month at the last SG9 meeting, there's a sense that because the Winter Olympics will take place in Korea in 2018, they're going to rush to actually try to deploy already some 5G networks by that time. So there's some interesting move in that space. If we look at some more in-depth example in the IEC world, we're very fortunate in SG9 to have one utility expert from Canada. He has listed for me some potential application in the, let's say, utility-related field. And you can probably see that those use cases ran from the generation to transmission and distribution, starting with the SCADA up to the meter itself. So there are really a very wide range of use cases you can really think of when talking about 5G. Now, coming a little bit more specifically to 3GPP, we had a deeper look at this organization. The previous speaker already introduced it as a public-private partnership. It's not really organized like a traditional industry consortium. You will basically find the main partners called organizational partners, which are SDOs, whether national or regional. ETSI, of course, playing a very big role in Europe. And their mandate is really to develop and maintain over the long run the whole G series, starting from the very first GSM up to 3G, 4G, and now 5G. They look at radio technologies, core networks, service architectures, and interestingly, they also publish their specification free of charge, which is some kind of, sounds like, wow, at the IEC, we're still in the old model, so perhaps we need to think about this as well. Now, if we look more, let's say, deeply at the membership, you will also find some other types of partners in 3GPP. We reviewed as part of SG9 the different type of partnership models. One interesting one is they have market representation partners. So those partners are, if you look at the screen there, mostly industry associations. They're not really setting standards in 5G, but they have usually a market opinion about 5G. You have individual members as well, which are usually companies, which are members of ETSI, well, and the others, let's say, main partners. You look at the demographics there. You see ETSI, again, has a really big share of all the individual members, about 550 total. And you find also observers. There are some observers which might become, in the future, a real partner of 3GPP. So within SG9, we kind of reviewed all those models, and we tried to kind of frame some draft recommendations along four scenarios, which are listed there on the screen. The first question we were asked was, should the IEC become a main partner, an org partner of 3GPP? To be honest, we don't really believe this is the right model, because if you look, at least today, in the current setting, at those org partners, they're mainly national or regional SDOs, and they have a really clear focus on setting standards on cellular technologies and 5G, which is not the case of the IEC today. When it comes to a market representation partner, we found the model potentially interesting. actually the discussion in the group came from the fact that we believe our technical committees should be able to send their requirements to 3GPP. We should find channels for all our committees to say, well, you guys doing cellular technologies, please make sure when you talk about smart manufacturing, when you talk about smart energy, you take into account the work we're doing at the IEC. So that's perhaps one model we could look at in the future. Of course, liaison between IEC committees and 3GPPs should be considered. We believe this is one of the main avenues. There's already a liaison between CISPR and 3GPP, and we would definitely encourage specific technical committees to establish liaison with that organization. And lastly, perhaps another recommendation could be for individual companies which sit on both sides, and we have many of them within the IEC and within 3GPP, to act also as bridges between those two organizations. So those were pretty much some kind of draft recommendation we put together. We will come back to the SMB at the next SMB meeting in February with something a little bit more compelling as part of our final report. And it's definitely open for discussion. I will be very pleased also to hear what you think about it. So as a conclusion, I would say 5G might be a hype, might be a buzzword, but it will be definitely an important technology, an important driver for the Internet of Things, but not the only one. There will be a wide array of technologies to be considered to make the IoT a reality. Seeking engagement with 3GPP seems to be important. Liaison might be the very first thing to do, and potentially consider other avenues as what we call the bilateral meetings that we should probably set up with that organization. And let's not forget as well other key stakeholders in the 5G, such as ITU, with which we have already some strong relationships, and IEEE as well. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jill. So we thought 5G will be the technology where we can just wait and sit back and everything will then run automatically. Unfortunately, it's not the case. Yeah, last but not least, we are now starting with IEEE, and Heinrich Munz is the lead architect of Industry 4.0 at KUKA Robots, and he will update us regarding smart manufacturing. And afterwards, we will have the second poll. And this poll is related to the Internet of Things, which we then will raise together. By the way, if you have any questions for the speakers after the presentation of Mr. Munz, we will then have an open Q&A. So let's take a view on IEEE and Heinrich Munz, what here are is going on, wired and wireless solution with IEEE. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, yeah, my name is Heinrich Munz. I'm a lead architect for Industry 4.0 at KUKA. And I'd like to share with you some thoughts about the standardization for Industry 4.0 regarding machine-to-machine communication, wired and not wired. So maybe not all of you may know KUKA. KUKA is an automation company headquartered in Augsburg, Germany, and we consist of four companies. One of them, maybe the most one you might know, is KUKA Robotics, and these are our products. So we are making industrial robots as well as collaborating robots, which is the silver one on the upper left-hand corner. We also have mobile devices, so mobile communication is also very important for us in industrial automation. We have what we call OmniMove platform, which can carry robots but also goods. Here you can see the collaborative robot mounted on such an OmniMove platform. So this is made for humans working together with robots. So these kind of robots, you can imagine in plants, are running around together with humans, and they will interact with each other, and of course these robots have to be very safe. So I'm talking a little bit about the requirements of Industry 4.0, and I want to give you a small brief definition of what we understand about Industry 4.0. So Industry 4.0 is a German name for the industrial Internet of Things. So it's the Internet of Things used for industrial production. There are other sectors, and here is a picture from Beecham Research, which I found very good because it describes in a little overview the whole Internet of Things and all of its what they call service sectors. And these sectors are buildings, so professional buildings, energy, consumers and their home, their private homes, healthcare. And this is what we define as Industry 4.0, industrial production. And this is only the little red signed part of it. Transportation, retail, public security and safety, and finally the infrastructure, the IT and networks themselves. They are also part of the Internet of Things. And there in Germany, we already heard that from the former speakers, there is what we call Platform Industry 4.0 in Germany. This is an organization, the official Industry 4.0 organization in Germany, driven by the government. In the meantime, it is one of 10 future projects from the German government, a lot of money in grants in it. It's controlled by the German government. Angela Merkel herself, our chancellor, often talks about it. It's very important for her. It's driven by two ministers, and I am honored to be vice chairman of the working group number one in this Industry 4.0 platform. And this working group number one deals with reference architecture. Maybe you heard about the RAMI 4.0 model already. And with standardization. So it's, of course, very important for us in Industry 4.0 that we have a common standard, for especially for machine-to-machine communication. Because without such a standard, machines cannot talk to each other. And just to give you an impression of the mess of today, what we are suffering from. Today, we have for machine-to-machine communication so-called field buses. I don't know if you're familiar with this topics, but this is what we are using, or we must or have to use in our industry today for machine-to-machine communication. And there is also an IEC standard, which is the 61158. It standardizes 19, believe it or not, 19 different field buses, which are completely not compatible with each other, which are completely different from the connectors, from the cable, from the protocols, from everything. And this is a standard. It's crazy. And here are a little statistics on that, how big the market shares of these field buses are, and from whom, from which companies, automation companies, they are driven. It begins here with Rockwell Automation, the Ethernet IP field bus, and Siemens with Profinet. And by the way, as you can see on the right-hand corner, upper right-hand corner, these are the so-called industrial Ethernet field buses. They are based on the physical layer of Ethernet, more or less, because these companies already changed a little bit on the physical layer. So, it's everything else but Ethernet. Beckhoff, Modbus TCP, PowerLink, other field buses, and then we come to the field of the legacy field buses. Though these are the former field buses before the Ethernet-based field buses was invented. And here also are the companies who are driving these standards, so Profibus from Siemens, Modbus from Schneider Electric, CC-Link from Mitsubishi, DeviceNet from Rockwell Automation, and a lot of others. And as I said, connectors, cable, physical layer, everything is completely different. And of course, it's obviously, there cannot be an interoperability between these different systems. You only can make one machine using one field bus to communicate with another field bus by using so-called gateways. They are hardware boxes. They cost a lot of money. And they are killing deterministic. They are killing bandwidth. They are killing nearly everything. So this absolutely makes no sense. And let me just point out what is also interesting, the market shares. So everybody is talking about Ethernet nowadays, but as you can see, the not Ethernet-based field buses have a market share of 58% percent still. But also what is interesting, if you look at annual growth, it's only 7%, so this seems to fade out. Then let's talk about the industrial Ethernet. The Ethernet-based field buses, they have only a market share of 38%. It's much less than the old field buses, which are 20 years old. They are still widespread and still the big part of the nodes which are out there. But the annual growth of those are 20%, so this looks good. And then I want to point out, and this is also part of my speech today, that the wireless only has today a market share of 4%, but what is interesting is the annual growth is 30%. So as you can see, wireless will get very important in our industry. But these pictures here does not include the new upcoming standard Ethernet as it is, without any special manipulations from those companies at all. This is not shown in the slide here because it does not exist yet. Why is standard Ethernet not used in this in our industry until now? Because until now Ethernet was not deterministic real-time able. And when we talk as a machinery vendor, when we talk about real-time, this does not mean fast. Real-time is not fast. Real-time is deterministic. So this is often mistaken by people who are not so heavily involved in our business. Don't mistake real-time for fast. And so, because other industries also have recognized this problem, and it started with the audio and video people, there was founded a subgroup in the IEEE 802.1 standardization group, which are caring about Ethernet, the official Ethernet guys. And a subgroup was founded, the so-called time-sensitive networking subgroup. And as I said, it came from the audio and video people because they complained that carrying a video or a video movie over Ethernet, there were glitches and stops in the picture and so on, and this is bad. So they asked for a deterministic Ethernet so that it's guaranteed. And it's not only bandwidth, it's deterministic. And this is where the big breakthrough came, the car manufacturers, they also discovered Ethernet for inside the car. So probably in the future, you will find inside your car only Ethernet connections anymore. No more proprietary buses like they are using today, like CAN, MOST or FlexRay, these are the standards today there, but they also are going to Ethernet. And you can imagine if in every car on this earth, Ethernet will be built in with, I don't know, maybe 100 nodes in each car, this will be a very, very huge number of connected nodes where Ethernet is used. And so the price will go down and the quality will go up. Using these kind of technology. So number three now, the third industry which are jumping now on the TSN train is industrial automation. And we want and we need TSN for our future plans. And here is a picture of the standards we are using right now in Industry 4.0. And I only want to point out the lower on the left-hand and on the right-hand side, which is OPC-UA on the right side, and which is TSN, IEEE 802.1 TSN on the left side. So we need TSN to make the Ethernet hard, real-time able, deterministic. But that's not enough, because TSN is only the layer 2. And to explain that, I have here a picture from Professor Wahlstuhl. He is the CEO of the DFKI, a German Institute for Artificial Intelligence, and he is one of the fathers of Industry 4.0. So he has, together with Mr. Kagermann and Mr. Lukas from the German government, Mr. Kagermann was a former top manager from SAP, they have written the first white paper about Industry 4.0. And Mr. Wallster has put this slide on, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago. And this shows the complete 7 layers of the ISO-OSI model for communication. And as you can see on a very low layer, there is Ethernet on layer 1 and 2. But we need, and this is what Mr. Weisler did not think at that time, 2 years or 4 years ago, that we need deterministic Ethernet. So we need the TSN in addition on layer 2. Then we will have, of course, TCP/IP, UDP/IP on layers 3 and 4. And then, and this is also very important, we need also on layers 4, 5 and 6, and even 7, we need a standardized protocol or technology which all agree on. Because if everybody is using something else on top of TCP/IP, then it's even not interoperable. So our working group number 1 has now we came to the conclusion that we suggest officially OPCUA as the layers 5, 6 and 7. As I said, TSN only addresses layer 2. For full interoperability, we need all the layers. And we have suggesting OPCUA for the higher layers. And what is important, I want to point out here, above layer 7, unfortunately that's a slide in German, but this says semantic self-description. Every device, every automation device of the future must have a semantic self-description. It must describe itself. And OPCUA is a perfect technology for that because it's not only a protocol. OPCUA is much more than a protocol. It also has the features of a data model, so you can describe the communication and the features of the device. And so this is why the VDMA also jumped on that train, and now the VDMA is putting together an OPCUA guide for its members, and this will come out soon, probably at the end of the year. And all the different subdivisions within the VDMA are asked to write such kind of semantic self-descriptions. In the meantime, 4 subdivisions of the VDMA already started to write such kind of semantic self-descriptions in OPCUA language. These are called companion specifications for their specific devices. So there will be a companion specification for robots, there will be a companion specification for grippers, there will be a companion specification for valves, for motors, for drives, for whatever you can imagine as an automation device. This will be described in a companion specification under the hood of the VDMA. And so if you are a member of VDMA, I have a call for action for you. Please get involved in this effort and talk to the VDMA, or Mr. Dr. Mosch is here, the driving guy, or talk to Mr. Hoppe from the OPC Foundation, or talk to me and I can bring you in contact to the right people and work with the VDMA to define your kind of devices in a semantic self-description called OPCUA companion specification. Okay, and finally, I have here a nice little picture what I want to share with you, which describes which way all the mechanical engineering companies like KUKA Robotics have to go in a few years to make Industry 4.0 a reality. On the left-hand side, you see nowadays from mechanic companies, the big thing which they only think about is mechanic. There is a little bit software and a little bit more of electronics, and outcome in between comes the system thinking, and this is wrong. In the future, at first, they have to think about software. Software, software, and software again. Mechanics is only an enabler for the business. It's not the main topic, it's an enabler. Electronics, of course, is getting more and more important, but Moore's law and Nielsen's law are taking care for that, that we get more and more and powerful electronics. And as you can see, what is new compared to the old world is the yellow circle, mobile communications. Mobile communications will be very, very important of the machines of the future. And of course, and this is what we, why we are doing the whole stuff, new services, new business services, but also new machine services will come out of this game. Okay, and that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Munz, for your presentation. Okay. And it was impressive to see how KUKA is transforming from a mechanical company to a software and system company in the next years. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, now we have the second poll, and I please ask you to use your smartphone that we are checking out the second poll, and then we will have a Q&A with all of the speakers where you can ask the people about questions which you want to raise up. So the second poll, please take your smartphone, and then I please ask the speakers to come to the stage again.
Hier stimmen.
Ach so, okay. Yeah, you can come all together. So we have a microphone.
Das Problem ist nur, das versteht kaum jemand, was ich da sage.
Yes. Okay, let's see the first app result, the first result of the app poll, which we raised in the beginning regarding security. If we can get the result on the screen. Mr. Lichtenecker. Yes, this is the result. And my first question is to Mr. Schlesinger. Is this result reflect your opinion, or what is your thought about it?
I would personally think that standards will always be a basis for safety and security, and I deliberately use both the word safety and security because they're very different. And they can be used, and I maybe remember the one slide I used about a holistic process. They can really be used to structure a process where you can achieve safety and security. But will a standard be enough to say, I'm certified according to the so-and-so standard, I'm safe and secure? Certainly not.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions from the audience to the people? Now you have the chance to ask them whatever you want regarding the presentations they made. Yeah, I have also another question, but you answered it already regarding the hacker attacks, China and USA were in the ranking list in the top. Are there too many students which have too many time, or where's behind them?
Well, first of all, there's demography. US and China are just large in terms of quantity of people. So statistically speaking, there have to be more attacks. That's the first thing. The second thing is, it's not just students. Obviously, there's also students. But what we do see is the activity of organized crime and nation states. If you look at the Stuxnet virus, there's been a great movie out there. It was called Zero Day. I don't know if you've seen it. Watch it. Where it actually was made quite clear that a virus or a worm of the complexity of Stuxnet can only be written by a professional organization. Clean code, and no artifacts, very complex, 4-0 exploits. Yes, there was China. Yes, there was the US. There's a certain indication that nation states do engage in this space. Maybe these two nations are there, but it's not something which should be surprising.
Okay, thank you. Let's take a look on the second poll result. I hope we have already the result. And I want to pick up now to Jill the result. And it is a big commitment to your group, isn't it?
Well, actually, it looks like people have attended the IoT workshop organized by the SMB we had on Tuesday.
Okay.
Actually, on Tuesday morning, we had a workshop on IoT with several speakers. And there was a call for the IEC to really take the lead on the IoT in collaboration, of course, with other organizations. So I guess that reflects very, very well the result of the poll here.
OK. But I want to come back to 5G. Do we underestimate 5G as the key for Internet of Things? Or is it just another hype like 3G was or 4G? What is the real, I mean, if we are looking around, 5G is a buzzword where you can read and hear everywhere. So do do we? Is there not a little bit fear that we are see our train is running away, driving away?
Well, I think I would say the answer is probably yes and no. There's definitely a lot of hype. As we have seen, everything around mobile phones, everything around cellular technologies is really a hot topic and has a profound impact on the society. I was reading this morning, well, you heard about all the troubles Samsung had with their latest mobile phones, and I was reading this morning that the Central Bank of Korea has been extremely concerned that the growth of the country will decrease because of this incident. So the whole field of mobile communication is both a hype, but it has a lot of impact as well on our society. So we believe 5G will have a really big influence, but we need to be careful and we need not to summarize IoT with 5G only. It will be, again, a really wide range of technologies, and the key will be integration and interoperability.
Thank you. We talk about sustained collaboration, and the Standardization Council is a German initiative. But I mean, this concept, is there not any interest from other countries where we can come together and extend this German approach?
Yes, of course. This is also one of the strategic and major goals, what we have to cooperate with other countries. And we have still some of activities which we already started, for example, with China. And we are starting also now with Japan and with Korea. And of course, with the US, we already had some meetings, the first one in New York 2 months ago. So we try also to get the most important topics which are has to be discussed so far and right now and which are really urgent. So we also discuss these topics like reference architecture model, for example, with other countries or wireless or now the new one 5G and of course security, IT security. So and we think this is very important and these are very fruitful discussions to harmonize with other countries, some processes and some topics, let's call it like this. And even there is the G20 conference next year, and even standardization is one of the topics which will be discussed at the G20 next year. So we had some discussions already with the Ministry of Economy, where we put all aspects regarding Industry 4.0 in that package, and we try to bring it in this G20 paper for discussions of the, let's call it, leaders of the countries. No?
Wow, it sounds like a journey around the globe, and so I hope you enjoy also the different dinners there with the different cultural aspects.
We are flexible.
Good. Yeah, Mr. Hule, 9 weeks is Christmas, and if I would be the Santa Claus, what shall I leave under your Christmas tree regarding spectrum?
As we talked about the studies which have to be completed, then of course a complete study would be very helpful, then we are quite in time to do further work on it. But this is really the thing, we need the cooperation and we need the commitment of industry. So my wish list would be complete the studies as fast as you can. Give us the good support as you did in the past with your research projects. Of course, IEC assist us in every effort to come to the ITU, and then industry commitment, that the companies send their experts to the relevant working groups. And for this, for example, we have an initiative in ZVAI dealing exactly with this, and I think it's on a good way that we are represented in the new process, which is really new for us.
Okay. You are also dealing, of course, with European Commission and also with the regulators on European level. What is there, the feedback and activity regarding that? Is there any support or what is there the status from that point of view?
In fact, we did not take up the contact to the European Commission yet in this respect. We had our discussions with them in former days regarding this European standard, which prevents us from using the 2.4 gigahertz band. Yeah, but this was not fruitful. Yeah, it did not lead to a result. So I think the way will be to go via national authorities, not only Germany, other countries as well. And this is what we promote in our industry association in Europe, for example. And then, if necessary, go to the European Commission too. Of course, the DG Connect play a big role in all this. And the CEPT, for example, the European Conference on Telecommunications and Post, yeah, who deals with these spectrum matters in the worldwide game, in the ITU, we have to contact them too, that's quite clear. And we started with this, but there was no concrete action yet. This has to be elaborated. Now we focus on the studies and accompanying the working party 5D.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned that wireless is growing, and here we have with resolution 958 an option to describe the future communication standards. I want to pick up, KUKA is working, is producing robots, and when are robots will be replaced by, when will be humans replaced by robots in the future? This is the key, I guess.
I have a micro. Well, what does this have to do with Wi-Fi or with wireless? But anyway, well, this question always is asked, of course. And well, the answer is always the same, yes and no. Of course, every time in history, when a new invention came out, especially regarding industry, and remember the first industrial revolution, the invention of the steam machine by James Watt, it turned over the whole world. And this happened all the time in human history. A second, my most loved example is, think about the sailor ships. When they had sails on it, and the sailors must have known how to handle these sails. And then the sail ships have been disrupted by steamboats. Well, what did happen to all these, I don't know, million sailors which knew how to handle sails? They were no more needed at that time. So several things happened. They retired because getting old, or they changed their work and was heaters on a steamboat, or I don't know, did something completely different. And this happened all the time in history. And with robots, it will be exactly the same thing. Some jobs, of course, will be replaced by robots, but these are even not jobs not worth being done by humans, because they are dirty, they are heavy, they are unhealthy, and a lot of things. And this is good that they are being replaced by machines. Also, history shows that in these situations, if there is a new invention coming up and replacing some of the jobs, and if it's a good thing, then the economy gets grown more and more, and this produces much more new jobs than the old one which has been gone away. And so this exactly will be the same thing with robots, but this will happen not from today to tomorrow, but there will be a migration path to that. And number one, what will happen is that robots will, especially the collaborating robots, because they are able to work together with humans, they will assist humans, to help humans on their daily job. For example, if the humans have to carry a heavy weight, a robot could help. Or if a human have to do, I don't know, putting screws in some boxes or whatever, the robot could assist and show the human where to put the things onto it. And there are a lot of use cases which we can imagine where robots could assist humans, not replace. And this is the reason why we named our new product, the collaborative robots. They are called IWAS, IIWA. Which stands for Intelligent Industrial Worker Assistant. This is very important. We see robots as assistants for humans, not as replacements for them.
Okay. Alec, a difficult question. What is your expectation? When will be manufacturing transformed to smart manufacturing? I mean, you have shown us very nice slides, but what is your real expectation?
There is no endpoint. It's hard to say what an endpoint is. When I came into the industry in the 68, I had dreams of building the first lights out 24-hour operating factory. I think there was one in my lifetime that ever worked without the people and humans and people being in charge. Technology has a wonderful way of setting expectations. And then the world and practice has a wonderful way of kicking you in the teeth. Industry, and particularly manufacturing industries, are still very conservative. If a production manager has got a line working and producing product, and it's making money, you're not going to get very much success trying to go in there and say, I've got this new widget and I want to try it out on your line. Okay. He will say, maybe come back in a year when we maybe talk.
Okay.
So the pace of adoption of new technology in industry is very slow. You saw that with the statistics on the communications, the field bus. The old field bus technologies are still 58% of the market. Interestingly enough, the Ethernet field buses are 38, but they are growing more. And then the wireless is even 4, but it's growing even more. So technology will get adopted, but it will get adopted over time. We will get smarter. The smarter we get, the more we learn, the more we find we're not as smart as we thought. So there will be constant evolution and constant development and change. We're on a journey. We've said we've been through revolutions. We've been through the Industrial Revolution. We're now at the beginning of the Internet of Things. I guarantee within 10 years, we'll have another buzzword of something to do with cloud or virtual reality or something else will be mature enough to grab the public's attention, then everybody's going to be writing standards for ABC. Well, at least they'll have a nameplate and a committee.
Okay. So yeah. The replacement rate of the industrial infrastructure give us the speed of the transforming process from manufacturing.
It's going to get bound to the speed of the adopting of the technology. If the new technology is going to make a significant impact and difference to the productivity and the manufacture of the products that are required by the customer, the adoption will be quicker. If the new technology is an incremental increase, it will get adopted in new installations.
Okay.
But you won't upset a money cash machine to stop because of an incremental benefit. It would have to be a significant benefit to the bottom line.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, 2 hours almost gone, I guess.
Thanks.
Oh, there's a question, sorry. You have the microphone? Yeah.
My name is Renata Wank, I'm from DKE. I have a question to Mr. Schlesing. You have told us about this amazing experiment. I'm interested in if you plan to make a product or service from it, and how far or how close are you to aim it, and how should it look like?
Well, we're not productizing it. It was an experiment basically to get a threat landscape. We still do have the gear. I have to admit we're shipping it now to the Center of Excellence for Digital Services in Singapore to do the same experiment on a different continent. What we do offer, though, is penetration testing. So we do test infrastructures as a service on industrial and also enterprise IT protocols. So it's productized, but not as a product, as the box itself, as a service. And to be totally honest, the Honey box, we didn't build ourselves. There's great companies out there that actually do it for business.
Thank you.
Yeah. Last question. Okay.
Okay. I wanted to talk about whether or not standards are easily available to people and whether they are published openly and they can be implemented under fair and reasonable terms. You're talking now of coming away from the SDOs like ISO and IEC and ITU that have a common patent policy. Many of the consortia have different favoritism for their members. Some developers of standards, even in IEEE, for example, are very closed shop. Their output is not open. There is no general involvement. How do you see this affecting the way you are looking at increasing collaboration across all SDOs and consortia when they have such different approaches?
Yeah, I can speak for what I have presented. IEEE 802.1 TSN is a completely open working group. I've shown you the URL, you can look into it. They publish everything what they are doing, PowerPoints, PDF documents, everything, you can read it. And finally, you will find it in your Ethernet devices. So TSN is absolutely open. Number two, OPC-UA, by the way, it's an IEC standard. I forgot to mention that. and the same thing, it's an open standard, not only driven by one company like the field buses, which stands in a shadow behind it, but it's a consortia of different companies, and the board of directors are changing from time to time. companies going out, companies coming in. So it's completely open, and this is very important, you can download for free from their website open source code to implement the OPC UA stack. It's not as mature as a professional stack, which you can buy for money, but it's up to you as a customer which way you want to go. So this was also very important for us in HE1, in Industry 4.0 Platform Working Group number one, that we only suggest open standards, which means what I said. Everybody can look into it. There are no patents on it, and you can implement it.
Thank you. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, see it.
One more question.
Oh, okay.
Okay, sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. I am Khalid Distawi from Egyptian National Committee. First of all, I would like to thank you for this nice presentation and this good presentation. I also need a copy from all of this presentation and the approach for Industry 4.0. We need this approach. We need how this approach as a document in order to how to can copy this and how to implement this in our country. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, last but not least, Corina.
Okay. Third try. Well, thank you very much, gentlemen, for your very interesting presentations and the active discussion I've seen from back there. Thank you so much, Alexander, for hosting this session. And frankly, we've touched so many aspects of this important topic. I feel like I'd love to ask you just for a few sentences of conclusion to summarize up. I've heard from Alexander Macmillan that we have to bring the digital world to the standardization world. What would you be your most important takeaways of this session, Alexander?
Yes, I made my note during the presentations, of course, and I learned Spectrum for Industry 4.0 are being negotiated at the ITUR at the moment, at Working Party 5A and D, until the window on 2019, and IEC experts are now called to support this activity. 5G is a main driver for tactile internet, but not the only one. Means that we have to collaborate with 5G or with 3GPP to common understanding. Also, what is important, Industry 4.0 needs monitoring and security by design, as cyber attacks, threats are the dark partner of digitalization, to say it more or less clear. And the traditional mechanics companies becomes system companies where mechanics are only one or less or part of the whole system approach. And of course, what is also important, that we have to collaborate with forums and consortia to bring all together those stakeholders to build the Internet of Things, the buzzword today. Maybe in 10 years it is called later, another word, but these are the key essential to describe system approaches through all organizations. And the Standardization Council is one tool which we have implemented, and this could be a guideline where we could extend to other countries as well. This could be in conclusion regarding the speakers, and in general, I think what is important is also that we have to look on a reference architecture model, which we have to focus on, and also we have many small and medium enterprises, and those have a lot of solutions, products, concepts, and everything, and those must be run on test centers, that we are ready to describe the complex issues, smart manufacturing, all together in a common approach. That would be, I guess, smart manufacturing in the future.
Wow, a lot of food for further thought and discussions, I guess. And well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for attending this session. And as I always say, we have a very tight schedule in this reinvention lab, so stay on here in about, 15 minutes, we start with the next session on the Trinity of Standardization, and I'm sure it's going to be just as vivid and interesting as this session was. So thank you all for attending. See you here back here in 15 minutes, and thanks again to all of you.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting Communities. Reinvent Standardization.